you and good morning, Karen.
All right, for those who, I mean, they've watched the hearing yesterday, but clearly the good conduct time allowance law is getting a lot of bad rap these days.
Yes.
But let us go to the spirit of the law.
That's correct.
Okay, I have the law here. It's actually a very short law. It goes to just 3 pages.
Yes.
But what was the spirit of the law when it was crafted?
The spirit of the law is that precisely there is a provision in the law which came from our bill, House Bill 417, in the House, which was sent to the Senate.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what this is the result, is that Republic Act 10592. In our bill 417, which is now Section 1 of the law, it is very clear that the good conduct time allowance can never be used for those who are, number one, recidivist, number two, habitual delinquents, third, escapists, and fourth, those charged with heinous crimes. They are excluded from the law. They cannot get good conduct because of the gravity of the crimes that they have committed.
Okay, but first, why was the law even crafted, considering we do have pardon and we have parole that is essentially vetted by the Board of Pardons and Parole? You have executive clemency that the president can grant. Why did the country even think of a GCTA?
Well, the GCTA goes all the way back to our Republic Act Revised Penal Code of 1932. And this came all the way from the Código Penal of Spain and implemented here. So the good conduct has always been there because we believe that our justice system should not be retributive. Mm-hmm. It is reformative and rehabilitative.
Mm-hmm.
And that is why it's there in the Revised Penal Code. We only amended it to be able to increase, in our case, to be able to cover even those under preventive detention. Because the Revised Penal Code only gives good conduct allowance only to convicts of final judgment.
Mm-hmm.
So we had that to include that so that we can have those who are have good behavior, who are not in these exclusions, will be given a chance in life.
Okay.
That is what we have.
All right. Based on the Senate hearing yesterday, under the good conduct time allowance law, can you clarify essentially what was abused in the law or misunderstood that's been practiced? Since 2013, there are close to 2,000 inmates that have already been released. Number one, do convicts of heinous crimes qualify under the good conduct time allowance? Yun muna. Regardless, let's say, if it's not Mayor Sanchez.
Yes.
You committed a heinous crime, pero nagbago ka sa loob ng kulungan. Do you qualify under GCTA?
They will not qualify because precisely our law here provides, and if you can read the law, the second page, it says here on Section 1, the law is very clear that finally, that recidivists, habitual delinquents, escapists, and persons charged with heinous crimes are excluded from the coverage of this entire act.
I see.
Act, not only of the section, but the entire act.
Yeah. So recidivists is one excluded, delinquents excluded, escapees and caught again excluded, and another one is those convicted of heinous crimes.
That's correct. It's in the law.
Whether or not the one convicted of a heinous crime has changed.
Correct. It is not. It has never been the intention because of the gravity of the crime. So therefore, they are excluded. We made sure about that. And it's in the law. And if you harmonize that to the entire law, it is clear that we exclude these 4 classifications of convicts.
So technically speaking, Director General Nicanor Faeldon broke the law.
He did. He did not harmonize the law. He did not see that this exclusion is to the entire act because it's just coverage of the act. So therefore, there should have been no release, absolutely no release of those involved in heinous crimes.
Okay, so to clarify, hypothetically, let's say the Chong inmates, one of them became a born-again Christian, became a pastor, asked forgiveness from the family accepted, they're still not qualified.
They're still not qualified because we believe that the gravity of the offense requires that they stay in jail. Can you imagine former Mayor Sanchez? He was convicted of kidnapping, rape, murder, 3 immediately of the heinous crimes, and then you release them in violation of this law? So that is what we have, including the Chong sisters. Rape and murder, and you release them?
Yung driver na iwan, he was the lookout, yung tatlo, who were convicted of actually committing the crime.
Yes.
were released.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, the driver question.
Was, yeah.
What about drugs? Because was drugs a heinous crime in the past?
In 1993, the law on heinous crimes have enumerated as heinous crimes, Karen. First is murder, rape, kidnapping with illegal detention, robbery with violence, intimidation. This is the law. And those convicted of dangerous drugs. It is very clear there. And destructive arson. These six are listed in the heinous crimes law. So therefore, when we have that 417 bill which became law, very clear when we say heinous crimes, it is defined by law.
So technically, even right now, there are eight drug, well, supposedly five Chinese drug lords and three involved in drugs, drug-related cases released.
Yes.
Dapat hindi rin ni-release yun.
Definitely. Because drugs under the our law, 10592, excludes the drug convicts. Mm. That is
so
clear.
My question is, if this is the spirit of the law, why didn't the law just say you can those who can avail of GCTA can only be under minimum security and medium security? Bakit hindi nyo specify na pag maximum security ka, which is usually heinous crimes, right? You are not included.
Well, it is clearer to have heinous crimes, the statement of heinous crimes, because heinous crimes are defined by law, the law on heinous crimes of 1993. So therefore, it is very clear. The Bureau officials would know that.
Okay.
Why is it that they have closed their eyes on that particular provision? That is the question now.
Okay. Number two, based on this alone, should Fael Don be removed? Fired? I mean, he refuses to resign. But how can he be removed if only the president can remove him? I mean, what recourse is there considering, as you say, he broke the law, which is quite clear?
The same law on section here, that is section 5, it says here, who grants time allowance?
Okay? Yeah.
And then this is clearly, the director, that is filed on. And then also the chief of the Bureau of Jail and Management and or the warden. That's why the warden in Iwahig is released.
Yeah, yeah.
They're given they will give the time allowances. But there's a penal clause. This is where the Bureau officials will be liable. Faithful compliance with the provision of this act is hereby mandated. Faithful compliance. As such, the penalty of 1 year imprisonment, a fine of 100,000 pesos, and the perpetual disqualification to hold office shall be imposed against any public officer or employee who violates the provision of this act. Mm-hmm. This is where he will be liable, section 6.
So does this mean that Fael Don has to be sued, charged?
Yes, definitely. We have also a due process. We cannot say you resign. We cannot say that because he would also have his defenses. Mm-hmm. Let the administrative process go, which is the administrative is can be investigated by the Department of Justice, and penalty there is dismissal, and then he could be charged also together with all the others who are members of the management evaluation screening committee who has really screened them and have recommended their release. They will be liable.
Okay.
And that is therefore administrative liability and criminal liability.
Okay, so one thing you're saying is clear is Nicanor Fael Don is liable.
He is liable. As far as I see, the clear spirit and intent of the law is that they should not release heinous crimes.
Okay. Question number two, Senator Ralph Recto brought it up. It was one of the last questions in the hearing. He said, he asked, if it is pardon or parole, the one who vets you essentially is the Board of Pardons and Parole.
Correct,
and then for pardon, the president has to sign off.
That's correct.
For parole, the president doesn't have to sign off.
Yes.
But the Board of Pardons and Parole will sign you off as eligible for parole.
That's correct.
Now, who has the last say in granting good conduct time allowance?
In our case, in this
based
bill,
on the law,
it is the Bureau of Corrections chief.
Okay.
Who grants it and who ordered the release. And that is what Fael Don did. He ordered the release of chances.
Okay. Just to clarify, this is not anymore the House bill. This
is
the actual law that's already been
combined by both houses.
So both houses agreed in 2013 that the Bucor Director General can release on his own.
Yes, because that is what
Does
the law
say?
Yes.
Because Senator
Alfredo asked. They will grant the allowance,
when you grant the allowance,
it also includes the release order. Yeah, there's no other mention here of a Secretary of Justice or the President. That is what we're going to amend.
I see.
The vetting process, because after what has happened, because if they just followed the law, Karen, it would be clear there'll be no controversy.
Yeah.
No release of heinous crimes offenders. So there'll be no problem. But what they did was that they released them. And so therefore, one of the amendments that we propose to be able to do on this law is the vetting process should go all the way to the office of the President.
Pati good conduct time?
Yes,
I mean,
because
in the United States and other countries, even in Europe, I'm curious, pag GCTA ba, I don't think it goes all the way to the office
because
of the President.
Because we have to have a vetting process, because if we only have the bucolas, what has happened here? No examination by the Secretary of Justice and to the office of the President. If the office of the President grants pardons, which may also be conditional, this is a release. You're a free man.
Yeah. Okay.
This is even a bigger benefit than
pardon.
Than pardon.
Pardon.
Yes. Because here, a pardon can have a conditional one. Good if it's absolute, so that's okay.
Yung parole may conditions.
Parole may conditions. But this one is a release. You are a free man after you are released. You have been considered to have served your sentence fully. That is what we have.
So technically speaking, this is what I wanted to ask you. When Faeldon reasoned out in the Senate, I followed the rules. Because Secretary Guevara said it did not go through him. Technically, nothing was broken there. Is that correct?
Correct. Because
based on
there
the law.
No, based on the law.
According to Faeldon, he said he did sign the memorandum of release, including Sanchez, but he stopped the process.
But it's a very weak argument. He only stopped the process because of the public outcry. In other words, if he was just left on that and nobody complained, the public did not complain and against this release, Sanchez would have already been out by now.
Okay. The law is a short law, huh?
Yes.
Doesn't it specify? I mean, clearly, you guys make the law, but then an IRR is meant to follow after, which is how the law,
implemented.
The implementing rules and regulations.
Correct.
Under the IRR, would you remember, Congressman, how the granting of good conduct time
I have read the IRR.
Okay.
They did not seem to incorporate what was stated in Section 1 to Section 3. In other words, Section 1 is about those who are preventably imprisoned will be given the benefits of the good conduct. So that is not a harmonization of the law, because the law should be harmonized. How can it be that for those who have been preventably imprisoned, detention prisoners before conviction, that this is not allowed to be counted, and yet you count it for those already convicted?